Hey, what's up, guys? Hope everybody's doing well and having a great day. In this video, we're going to take a look at a question that came up here in the last week or so as we've been looking at the volcanic activity regarding the La Palma volcano, and we're going to give a quick update on the situation in the Canary Islands, and then we're going to come back and look at a question. I've gotten two questions, actually, in the last week. One of the questions was, why are meteors not hot when they enter the atmosphere? You're looking at another meteor over Costa Mesa, California, from the American Meteor Society on the night of October 16th of 2021. I don't think this one went through the roof of anybody's house like we saw up in British Columbia, but nevertheless, that was another bright fireball, and there definitely seems to be an uptick in meteor activity. You can see over here at the American Meteor Society, 1, 2, 3, 4 different reports on the 16th, one on the 17th, one on the 18th, and I wouldn't be surprised if there's not one tonight and tomorrow night as they just keep coming. But somebody asked, why aren't meteors hot when they saw the one laying on that woman's bed from British Columbia? We're going to look at that question tomorrow. Today's question involves lava. Someone asked, actually two people, myself included, is a question I've had for a long time. Why is lava, and how does lava stay so hot, and how does it get so hot? And the biggest question I have is, how does it maintain this heat buried underground, and in fact, many miles underground in some cases? If you look at a campfire, and we've all been around campfires, when we're done with the campfire, a lot of times we extinguish it with soil. I know I have soil or rocks or anything that's in the area that can safely extinguish it when we're done with it. Well, this here is under an entire globe of soil, but yet it still seems to maintain and does maintain this incredible heat without oxygen. Campfires and the heat that comes from campfires definitely require oxygen. Why does this not require oxygen? That is molten rock. When it reaches the surface, we have events like we see over here in the Canary Islands with a volcanic eruption. Once the magma breaches the surface and is exposed to air, then it becomes lava. While it's underground, it's magma. Above ground, it's lava. But here's the headlines from La Palma, October 19th of 2021. Volcanic activity enters its 30th day. It began September 19th of 2021. And we're over here at en.as.com. More than 100 earthquakes in the last 24 hours. Lava flow now covers a surface area of 811 hectares. 35,000 earthquakes and tremors have been recorded in the last 30 days. Nearly 2,000 buildings have been consumed by lava flow. This is the most significant eruption since 1585, according to Copernicus. Lava forming a huge delta on La Palma West Coast. A delta has formed and it's claimed 40 hectares of new land from the Atlantic Ocean. And there's all kinds of new data down here below. You can see new photos of smoke and ash in the sky. More photos of bright orange lava. It almost looks like you're looking at a portion of the sun when you look at these large lava flows flowing across the island. We're going to come back and we're going to take a closer look at lava magma here in just a moment. But first, over here at the website, quick look at the moon today. It's 99% illumination. Tomorrow, October 20th, we'll see 100% illumination. Tomorrow will be the full moon. Looking at the Schumann resonance right now, not too much going on, a little bit of background noise. We do have a moderate geomagnetic storm, nothing major by any means. That's from the arrival, the predicted arrival. You can see that little bump right there, forecasted by the Space Weather Prediction Center, of a plasma cloud that departed the sun a couple of days ago. It did arrive. It's not creating, again, a large geomagnetic storm. Something very, very small. Hopping over to the Yellowstone supervolcano caldera, looking at the seismographs that monitor the mighty supervolcano. Over here, we're seeing signs of a little bit of magma on the move. That's what the dark blue represents over here. Red represent earthquake activity. You can see a small spike there, and it's very, very small. A little bit of localized activity, but we see more dark blue than anything. Dark blue represents a little bit of magma intrusion. For some reasons, like here at the lake seismograph, there's no data. And that could be from a simple mechanical glitch. But right now, everything looks pretty quiet at the supervolcano caldera. But now, back over to the La Palma volcanic eruption. And we're going to take a look at lava. It's magma before it becomes lava. The name changes when the magma breaches the surface of the Earth and it just exposed to air, and then it starts creating land in some cases. The larger volcanic eruptions create a lot of land. Smaller volcanic eruptions create smaller deltas or little additions to maybe existing islands. Mega eruptions many years ago could have created a large amount of land. But right now, we just simply want to ponder the question, why is magma so hot? Why is the inside of the Earth so hot and the outside so relatively cool? How does that even happen? So I'm going to read to you guys an article from scienceaz.com, and then I have a theory I want to add. Here's the layers of the Earth as you go down towards the center. We have, of course, the outer crust. That's where we live. Then you have the upper mantle and the lower mantle. You have the outer core and the inner core. The outer core is liquid iron. That's known as magma. It's so hot in the center of the Earth, it melts rock. When the iron liquid, the magma, makes its way up to the surface and breaches the surface in the form of a volcanic eruption. But nevertheless, once it comes up, it's as hot as the surface of the sun. How does that happen? If we were to remove all of the layers of the Earth would probably shine like a bright star, right? Based off of what we know. So I'm going to read a couple of paragraphs from this article, and then I'm going to offer a theory. How hot is the Earth's core? The Earth's core has the highest temperature of 6,000 degrees Celsius. That's over 10,000 degrees Fahrenheit, equivalent to the temperature of the sun. This figure is about 1,000 degrees Celsius, higher than previous calculations. The core of the globe is divided into an inner core and an outer core. The index difference between those two core types is about 1,500 degrees Celsius. It's the difference along that rotation of the Earth that generates the Earth's magnetic field. Why is the Earth's core so hot? Why is the temperature so high? According to scientific theories, there is a relationship between the Earth and the Sun. The Earth was originally a mass of hot gas and rotated at a great speed. Kind of sounds like Jupiter today. Then the hot gas became liquid and condensed, shrinking in size as it orbited the Sun on regular intervals. The mass of gas gradually took on a spherical shape, but it's still red hot. Over time, the Earth slowly cooled, an outer crust formed, and none of us know for sure how long that took. The bottom of the crust is still hot to this day, and that's what we were looking at here. The deeper down you go, the hotter it gets. And I look at a campfire. When you throw soil on a campfire, it smothers its oxygen source, and it can no longer radiate heat. This maintains a very hot temperature, as hot as the sun. Scientists think that the Earth's hot core is due to a combination of simultaneous activity of radioactive substances and residual heat from the formation of the planet. The heat in the core can most likely be accredited to three factors: the residual heat from when the planet was formed, frictional heating from denser materials falling down to the core, and heat from radioactive materials. So here's what we've got. We've got the center of the Earth, the Earth's inner core, about the size of the moon. That would be a solid piece of iron, according to what I've read. The outer core is liquid iron, what we know as magma, and it's about the size of Mars. Once again, as I stated earlier, if we took away all of the layers of the Earth as we know it, and we were just left with the inner core, it would more than likely shine like a bright star. It maintains its heat like a star, like the sun. The sun doesn't have layers like the Earth does, and it shines bright, radiates a constant heat. It's known as a variable star, but it's actually very consistent with regard to its solar output. Yeah, we have solar minimum and solar maximum, but even those aren't that drastic of changes. So what if the Earth were a star that was somehow encapsulated over the years, and over the years, all of these pressure points that have developed, known as volcanoes to us, and what you're looking at over here at Google Earth are 10,000 years of volcanoes, known volcanoes, on planet Earth. All of these red pins represent a volcano. Some are active, most are not active. To me, these are pressure points where magma has breached the surface of the Earth, creating what we know as a volcanic eruption. But what creates the volcano eruption? What triggers that force underneath the Earth to push this magma out the surface, depending on how long it lasts, it forms a mass of land. In most cases, as we know, very small, but in some cases, if you look back over millions of years, more than likely these volcanic eruptions have occurred over millions of years, creating all of the land that we know today. If you look back over time, how the Earth has changed, if you go back millions of years looking at the ancient Earth, it started out as just a few continents. Come up to today, and we have continents spread out all over the place. This is just what we know of our planet. This is all we know. We haven't been here for 700 million years, and the Earth has changed a lot over 700 million years. And from what we understand, the mantle of the Earth kind of floats on a layer of magma. And at times, that magma breaches the surface of the Earth, creating volcanic eruptions, and it is hot, hot as the surface of the sun. And that brings us back to the question, how does magma stay so hot and it's so abundant inside the Earth, basically hot enough to melt rock, finding its way throughout the surface of the Earth in the form of what we know as volcano eruptions? And you can see all of these pressure points all over the globe, and all of these volcanoes have erupted at one time or another, forming the land masses that we know today. Well, what if the Earth, the inside of the Earth, was some sort of a star? What if the inner core was a star that was just covered in multiple layers of mantles and crusts and water, and the star is in a constant state of trying to release itself? And who knows, maybe this is part of a star-forming process, that the inside of the Earth that we call the inner core, that just happens to be as hot as the surface of the sun, maybe it's trying to shed all of these layers that we have a name for and someday be as bright as the sun that we see in the daytime sky. I don't know, but I'm just trying to make sense of why it's so incredibly hot, how it stays so incredibly hot, and coincidentally, it is as hot as the surface of the sun. Thanks for watching. Have a super day, and be safe out there.